Today's move is another great way to introduce your writing, and it's perfect if you're working with any sort of historical sources or if you're writing about any sort of history in your writing. Today's move is called a primary source intro. Now, a primary source intro definitely requires primary sources. So a primary source is anything from the time that you are talking about. So yes, that could be potentially like a tweet that is happening right now if you're talking about something related to current events. But it can definitely also be something from historical time period that you are talking about as well. These can be editorial cartoons, they can be memoirs, diary entries, government documents. Anything like that is considered a primary source. So a primary source intro is also a variation of a scene drop intro. And if you haven't watched that video, I am going to encourage you to go back, check that out, because it'll probably give you a better idea of how to actually work with the mechanics of introducing a scene to your reader. But a primary source intro is going to do exactly what it says. It's going to use a primary source to introduce your writing. Let's see how Andrea Peitzer does this in her essay on Enemy Aliens for Lapham's Quarterly. When Archduke Franz Ferdinand was shot point blank in the neck on June 28, 1914, news of his assassination ricocheted from Sarajevo all the way across Europe before nightfall. In the ballroom of a Parisian amusement park that evening, Austrian painter Paul Cohen Portheim asked a Viennese count what he thought was going to happen next. "Why should anything happen?" replied the count, surprised. Cohen Portheim was comforted. There was no reason to cancel his annual trip to England to paint the cliffs of Devonshire. So, in this article, Peitzer is actually going to be talking to us about World War I internment camps. I know, it's something I barely knew about either. But these World War I internment camps were something that existed basically all throughout Europe during World War I. And our kind of protagonist here, Cohen Portheim, is going to find himself imprisoned in one. So Cohen Portheim, this Austrian painter, he is actually deciding right here in the introduction that he's going to go to England to paint the cliffs of Devonshire. And this is going to be his fatal mistake. Although not fatal, because, you know, he doesn't actually die. But let's look at some of the techniques that Peitzer used to actually set up her primary source intro. So throughout this essay, she is going to be using Cohen Portheim's memoir to kind of set up what she's going to be writing about here. And so as she was reading through the memoir, that's her primary source, she discovers this scene and realizes that it's the perfect way to set up the essay, because what she wants to do is to establish that people did not anticipate that World War I was going to start. So she does this in a couple of different ways. Let's look at a few of her techniques. First, she's going to connect the experience of the primary source to the larger historical narrative of the moment. So she says, the Archduke Franz Ferdinand was shot point blank in the neck on June 28, 1914. Almost all of us are familiar with this story, right? That the Archduke Franz Ferdinand was shot. It's the catalyst to World War I. It kind of starts this chain reaction. And so that is something that is very familiar to us. So even though we may not be familiar with this painter, Paul Cohen Portheim, we are familiar with the assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand. It connects us to the larger context in the historical narrative that she wants to discuss in her writing. Then she's going to quote the source. And by quoting the primary source, she's adding a little bit of validity to the writing, and she's actually going to make sure that the actual language of the primary source document is reinforced in this introduction. Then, just like in any other scene drop intro, she's going to use imagery and other descriptive language to set the scene for the reader and bring them into the historical moment. So she says things like, when he was shot point blank, and that the bullet, or the assassination, the news of the assassination rather, ricocheted from Sarajevo. She's sort of like bringing this like narrative, almost making it seem like even more exciting maybe than it was. And this almost, not necessarily exaggeration, but very pointed diction is going to elevate the tension, and that's what she wants to do. Later on, let's see how a few other historians use a primary source intro in their writing. may be thinking, hey, this is a little bit more complicated than some of our other moves, but don't worry, you can totally do this in your own writing. You just have to ask yourself a few questions. So which primary source have you been working with that might just be a really great way to connect the historical narrative or the bigger historical concepts that you're going to talk about in your essay or in your writing or maybe in your podcast or video? What primary source would actually be the thing that would give you a glimpse into a very personal experience that someone had in the context of this larger historical narrative? And then for the primary source that you've chosen, how can you then take that very almost like microscopic historical thing, whatever it is, how can you connect it to the larger historical context that you're talking about? What do you need to add for the reader that's familiar to them so that you can connect this very small thing to a much bigger idea and topic in your writing? And finally, what sort of imagery and descriptive language can you use to make the reader feel like they are in this historical moment, like they're right there with the primary source, finding out about whatever happened at whatever moment in time that you are writing about? Thanks so much for watching Mini Moves for Writers. We hope to see you next time, and don't forget to like and subscribe for more videos.